afternoon. My name is Ernie Hadrick. I'm a member of the Citizens for Better Norristown. And this is an NASD TV production. And our guest today is Mr. Michael Tolle. Mr. Tolle is an accomplished author, and he's done some work focusing on different issues in our community. And his current book, which we have here with us, is They've Been Down So Long, Getting Up Still on Their Minds. We welcome you here today, Mr. Tolle, and why don't you tell us a little bit about this book?
Thank you very much for having me here. I'm going to enjoy it. This book is the result of many decades of residence near Norristown. I spent 36 years with my family living along and occasionally in the Schuylkill River, just about a mile upriver from Norristown. I could see Norristown from my deck every morning, every evening when I sat out there. Now, I did not arrive in the neighborhood until about 1974. And at that time, when you drove into Norristown, it was a very, very sad view that met your eyes. And everybody had nothing good to say about Norristown. But over the years, over the decades, I did some work with my township government, working with the sewer system, coordinating with Norristown. I not so much came to love Norristown as to care for it, because it was clear to me, I'm a historian by training, that Norristown once was a beautiful, great place to be, to live, to work, to worship, and to shop. And so as I began to work as a college instructor at Delaware County Community College, then at Montgomery County Community College, I began to confront the problem that people always face in these kind of schools, which is, how do you teach history to people who really aren't the least bit interested in it? And I learned a very valid lesson from that teaching, because the students in my class were not there for some academic interest in learning more about history. They were there to make themselves better in some specific way. And so as I evolved my teaching techniques, trying to reach out and to actually get to these people instead of just having them memorize dates of who did what when, I began to view history as a tool, okay, for improving our life today and our lives tomorrow. In other words, if it's not relevant, then it's not that important. And that was the approach that I always took, and it has led me to the writing of two books, not just history books, but books from which I hope people will learn from history. The first one is called What Killed Downtown, Norristown, Pennsylvania, From Main Street to the Malls.
Now, when you say downtown, you know, most people in the community, especially these younger people, they have no idea what downtown Norristown was. And we all know that's not coming back. What we really need to know, how can we have a good economic situation in the future?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is very important to understand that it's not coming back. In other words, I didn't write that book as just as a memory of the way things were. I wanted people to understand why they changed. And what I discovered was that virtually everybody had a single opinion about why Norristown downtown died, and it was wrong.
I'm going to interject here. Citizens for Better Norristown, we have a Facebook page. We have about 800 people on that page, and we get your blog periodically. Most people, like myself, would say that the downtown went because of the mall at the King of Prussia and the plaza and the Plymouth Meeting Mall. What is your view on that?
My view is that the malls, the plaza and the Plymouth Meeting Mall, did not kill downtown. What they did was to greatly hasten, a process already well underway by the time the King of Prussia Plaza first opened in late 1962.
Well, when did downtown Norristown, and I know the answer to this because I read your stuff, but tell the audience, when did the Norristown decline really happened?
Okay, now if we're talking about downtown Norristown, okay, right. If you're looking at it on a purely statistical basis, how many businesses were there from year to year to year to year, what I discovered to my considerable surprise was that the high point for retail business in Norristown after the Second World War was 1954.
Wow.
After that, it was a slow and then a gradually accelerating decline for years before the malls even opened. They lost many of their big businesses. They had that enormous catastrophe of the Pigeonhole Garage, for example, all before the malls opened. The point here is, I guess, not too much to remember the answer to this question, but to understand that history is more complex than people want to think. People look for simple answers. There are almost never simple answers. There's a combination of things that involve.
Well, the migration, particularly the migration that changed the town dramatically in the 50s and 60s, which was African Americans coming here from Virginia, Maryland, South Carolina. How did that shape, or how did that coincide with things that were going on?
Well, one thing I like to make clear is that when I go out and speak, and in my blog people respond, they have this idea that the town went downhill because poor, largely black people were moving in, and that it caused the people with money and ability to leave.
Right.
That has it exactly reversed. People who are poor, regardless of your race or ethnicity, cannot move into a community that has a high property values. They can't afford it.
Gotcha.
The community has to be on the downhill with lower prices for them to move in the first place. Now, this does have an effect when they begin to show up, but it is not a causal effect. It's actually a result.
I know different parts of the town were occupied by the people who attended the churches that were in existence. You know, you had Irish Catholic, you had Italian Catholic, you had African American. Those folks sort of exchanged houses, you know, over the years. I know that the house that our family bought on Cherry Street was owned previously by an Italian family who, you know, had a wine cellar and the whole bit. But they were heading out as we were heading in. So you're saying that didn't shape though. It didn't really shape the exodus.
It contributed to the exodus after the exodus was already well underway.
Okay.
People did not leave because a black or somebody moved in next door to them.
Gotcha.
Now, why they moved, there's several reasons why they moved. I'm not going to argue any specific one, but here's where we can actually look at the federal government, where in the post-Second World War period, we decided to reward our veterans, a very justifiable topic. And so we, through several laws and changes in the structure, were able to spur the growth of what we today call automobile suburbs. In other words, it was almost free for a veteran of the Second World War to buy a house in Levittown. Almost, he could, no money down, very good payments, but if he wanted to take that money and rehab an existing beautiful old house in Norristown, it couldn't be done. And so our federal government very strongly encouraged people to leave our towns and to go to the automobile suburbs. Now, that's bad enough, but what the people who took advantage of this were the young people then coming back from the war, starting their families, the people with energy and drive and plans for the future and a family. These are the people that left. And Norristown and many other towns suffered because of this.
Well, what are some other factors that took us out?
There are three basic realities to life along the Schuylkill River. We keep it fundamental now. I mean, we stay away from names and politics as much as people would like
now,
to throw
that
in there.
Now, you know, folks are not going to understand this river concept that you have, you know,
right.
But it's so intriguing. Please continue. Okay.
Well, the river is one, or the first of the realities and the basic one. It's why people came here in the first place.
You're talking about dating.
Way long time ago. Okay, now back in the old days, although today you read about the Schuylkill River, you conceive of it as a highway. You think about things people traveled along it with their goods. But the fact remains that for about 99% of the population of southeastern Pennsylvania, the river was a barrier. It wasn't a highway. And so the important thing was, where could you cross it to get somewhere? And that's why every single one of the towns on the lower Schuylkill River emerged from a fording location, where you could actually cross the river. You combine that with nearby creeks sufficient to produce the manufacturers of the day, then you begin to get those clusters of people that begin to change an area from the surrounding farmland to something that would eventually become a town.
Okay. Wow. So what? When did that sort of occur for Norristown? At what point?
Well, Norristown.
We're like 200 years old now.
Yeah.
So
now Norristown was officially became a borough in 1812.
Right.
Now, arguably, it came into existence, there's a legal technical existence, in 1784 when the county of Montgomery was formed. Because when they split off Montgomery County from Philadelphia County, they picked Norristown, it was not Norristown, it wasn't anything then, to be the new county seat. There was nothing there. It was open ground. Now, the only reason they picked it, now, I should probably not say the only reason because I always know there's back behind the scenes, but it was located along the river. The specific creation of Montgomery County document specifies a canoeable location along the river. Now, the fact that it's a canoeable location tells you that there's a limit to how much that river could have carried. But was also as existing there was Swede's Ford. And so when you look at the growth of Norristown, okay, you find that it began like every others, but it began earlier than all the others. It has a specific difference in that it was artificially created by the county, whereas all other towns more or less organically grew from location.
Okay.
But the fact that they specified this as a county seat meant nothing. It was simply an open field. But what it had were the two best roads of the time at the intersection. Where they intersected is where the capital of Montgomery County was to be. Now that's Swede Street and Main Street, or wow. Ridge Pike, if you call it.
Wow. So you were here, you lived here around 35, 36 years, and during that time you developed this desire to delve into it?
Very much so. Yeah. I mean, once I finished my studies at Villanova and while I was studying history at Temple, I looking around, like any other historian, for something to focus on, to research and to write, and I said, well, it's right next door to me, the town of Norristown, because there's a story here. This was a beautiful, thriving, vibrant town. It was the commercial shopping center of Montgomery County and was for well over 100 years. And then, for reasons that most people misunderstand, it began to collapse.
Well, we all, if you talk to anybody that's over 60, maybe 50, they always say what it was. Well, what it will be won't be what it was. But what could it be, in your view?
Okay, you have really hit to the nub of the issue here, because the only reason to study history and to remember history is to understand that history changes. Okay, if history didn't change, there would be no history. The only thing that would matter is genealogy and what family you were born into.
Right.
But history does change. And if you appreciate those changes and don't look at the back and say, well, I'm going to recreate the past, I'm going to learn from the past because things have changed, then you have a much better chance of living a better life today and preparing for a better life tomorrow.
In your view, I know you've studied the history, but I'm sure you've looked at a little bit about what's going on here now. What, in your view, has to happen for us to get to a place of community improvement, economic improvement, what have you?
That's basically why I wrote this second book. Okay, the first book answered a question. The second book raised a question. Why did these things happen? And my book points out that Norristown is not unique, that what happened to it happened to virtually every other town on the lower Schuylkill River, and I think by inference a great many other old towns in American history. And so if you understand that things have changed, if you understand what has changed, okay, then you have a chance for the future. There's an old expression about those who fail to remember the past are doomed to repeat it.
Right.
Well, the way I phrase this is those who fail to learn from the past and try to repeat it are doomed. You cannot repeat history. What was, and it's not coming back. And that's what this book focuses on, because it stays away from names, it goes away from the easy explanations as to why things went wrong. And it's a complicated story.
So in your first book, the downtown was basically Norristown.
Yes.
Then you branched it out to seven other communities because you saw similarities in their development.
Right.
being in the same area and whatnot. How do you have a Conshohocken with restaurants galore and seems to be economically stable in Phoenixville? With, you know, you just spoke in Phoenixville recently. How do you match that up to what's going on here?
That's what a good half of this book does, because it's not more than half history. Right. The rest of it is a view of the present and the future, which is unusual in these books.
Right.
And so what I try to point out is that Norristown has the opportunity to come back. In fact, what I've recently started doing is blogging on Norristown, specifically because I think it is on the cusp
right.
of a revival.
Right.
But if we take the wrong paths, if we look at the past and instead of the future, we're missing the point.
You know, I've been around here for a couple of years, you know, like 65. I used to work right in this building where this studio is. And I've never seen anyone approach, you know, the future of this town by studying its history. And it's just... there might be other people out here who've done it, whatever you. And I just think that the historical approach, in many ways, is where we need to go. We have a lot of history here, that's just beautiful history. That other communities like Doylestown and whatnot, they're exposing to the public, and they got people coming in to share in the history. We don't do that at all. Mm-hmm. And my church, we just put in a historical marker. Well, we just got put on a national registry. There's tons of other buildings and locations in Norristown. It'd be great to have something of substance at the other organizations. But this is so important because it speaks to helping folks in the town, helping the government, if they would get a line or a path to follow. And I'm not sure if we're there yet. Not because nobody wants to, but it seems like we just don't know what to do. And you're outlining that we should at least be checking this thing out, you know? And we're not doing that right now. And that's, you know, that's not a discredit to you, but it's a discredit to us who don't want to really learn in a professional way.
This is the problem that I run across all the time. I ran across it from the start. I'm not a best-selling author. I confess that right up front. But I'm a very stubborn one. And so I'm going to keep working on this because I do believe, first, that Norristown can revive. I believe it should revive. And I think I have some ways to help it if people are willing to look at those.
Well, how much is the book?
The book is $19.95.
Okay, that's not too bad.
It is available retail locally only at the Historical Society of Montgomery County because there are no bookstores basically around here anymore. Otherwise, it's available on Amazon or from my website, which leads you to Amazon anyway.
Okay.
Now, let me give you sort of an example. It's not necessarily the most important one because it's a very general one, but we talk about the river, you know, and what it was and so on and so forth. But what most people don't understand is back in what we call the good old days, the river was little more than an open sewer. Human and industrial waste was indiscriminately dumped in there, and then we drew drinking water out of it. Now, the contradiction there was it took a long time for people to understand and appreciate that.
Right. But what years? Give me some years of reference.
Oh, the polluting of the river essentially began when the Europeans arrived. See, unlike the Native Americans, the Europeans settled and began to make waste that they did not use. Now, this continued and continued so that during the latter part of the 19th century, the early part of the 20th century, the so-called golden years of the town, and I think economically and socially they certainly were that, the river was not the least bit of an asset. If you look at every town today, and Norristown is a good example of this, look at the residences in a town. The lower people, the lower class people, the lower paid people had to live near the river. You can measure the wealth of a resident of Old Norristown by the distance away from the river that they could afford to live.
Really?
Now, the reason that all of these
How
towns...
How do you find that out?
That I basically found out by driving around Norristown and looking, and then driving around the other seven towns in my book and looking. They're all the same. The geography is different. Okay, the dates and the names will be different, but everything else is basically the same.
Would this have anything to do with the fact that the groups... or the ethnicities that inhabited those towns were similar, or were they not?
Well, the answer to that is,
You do similar things if you're from similar places.
Right. Unfortunately, the answer to that is both yes and no, because the third and, to my mind, the most important reality of the town, past, present, and future, are the people that came to live here. Now, these towns were initially founded by people who would have come from the Northern European Protestant origins that William Penn brought in.
Right. Okay?
But the towns themselves are the creation of wave after wave after wave of immigrants, beginning with the Irish in the early to middle part of the 19th century, through the Italians and all of the Eastern Europeans that came in pretty much at the end of the 19th century and the early part of the 20th century. What these people did was to periodically regenerate the spirit and energy of the towns. Now, when you arrive as an immigrant to a brand new country, you almost never arrive with any money. That's a very rare thing. You may not even arrive with particular skills that are all that useful or that all that well paid. But what you have is energy, determination, the willingness to work. Work hard. Even if it's not going to benefit you, if it's going to benefit your son or your grandchildren, you do it. Wow. And this is the spirit that built these towns. Now, before we get too much on the goody-goody side of this, there's another side of this coin that is equally as valid. Each time these new groups came in, they were treated with very much disdain and disrespect by the people already there. Now, the Irish experienced this, you know, no Irish need apply, Irish and dogs not allowed here sort of thing. And yet they settled in. They began to produce, they began to be part of the community. And then by the time the Italians, let's pick them out, began to arrive, what they discovered was the fact that they were discriminated against by the Protestants, who were still there and largely still in charge, but they were at least discriminated as much, if not more, by the Irish. The fact that they shared the same religion made no difference whatsoever. These new people were different.
What was the impetus to encourage the Irish to do that? What was the gain? What was the gain?
Well, for the Irish, the gain was to stay alive, basically.
Okay. It was a survival thing.
Yeah, it was a pure survival thing.
You won't come to take from me if you move in and do what you,
right.
you got to do.
Now, the Irish came because Ireland was in the midst of a potato famine. It had unfortunately established that crop as its primary crop. Millions of Irishmen died while landowners in England, adhering to a classic economic doctrine about not helping people because it ruins their, you know, their self-esteem and their willingness to work hard, simply didn't send any help.
The discrimination, as I see it, and working with NAACP and just living here, you know, I hear a lot of Italian folks who are friends of mine. They talked about these things, but I couldn't understand them because I was looking at things through my eyes. Through my relative's eyes, which was hardcore discrimination, is what we would call it. But it was still, to them, it was wrong. It was wrong. And so here you're saying that we've been built with a series of discriminatory errors.
Right, and that the evidence to that is in the local churches.
Right.
Where you can trace the history of a community by looking at what church was founded when. Because each time a group of migrants came into a town, once they had reached a certain number, they began to build their own church.
Wow.
And so when you look at the churches and the volunteer fire companies now, because they were at least as much social organizations, you know, as far as well as service organizations,
right.
These are the history of your towns. And what you have is, and exposes, I think, the myth of the melting pot. That never occurred in these towns.
Sure.
It did not occur
sure.
in Norristown, as you know
for sure.
full well.
For sure.
Now, we have discrimination, Irish against Italians, Italians against so on and so forth, but let me point out one thing. While all this is going on, perhaps the only thing these ethnicities could agree on was to keep the black people down. So there's racism as well as ethnocentricity involved in this discrimination situation.
You know, I was an older, at a later point in my life, when I realized that the Catholic churches were pretty much based on ethnicity.
Yes.
And when I, you know, when I realized it, like the Irish folks, great and large part, went to St. Patrick's. Holy Savior was the Italian church. I didn't get it. I didn't notice that. Because, we, you know, within our division, within the black division, there was no subdivisions of ethnicity. So we went, you know, our church, our first church of record was 1830. The church I belong to now, what he just celebrated, was 1840, which was an offshoot of that original church. And that original church became an AME church. And we were involved in another organization in Delaware. But the churches were such a significant fact, you know, a feature of our history. How do you see the churches going forward? Do you see it?
I see the churches making a contribution, but what I'm fascinated by is how, once again, the ethnicities in these churches is changing. Okay, this is a classic story. It happens on a fairly small scale with Protestant churches because they don't have a central organization. You read about it much more when Catholic parishes close, for example. But as people leave these old towns, the churches begin to suffer. Some move and some simply close down. And so you look around Norristown now, you find churches that were established by one religion and, you know, one ethnicity, now serving perhaps even another religion, if not that, certainly another ethnicity.
You know, we could talk all day, you know, and they've been down so long. They've been down, meaning the towns, and then on the backside, okay, getting up still on their minds, meaning that, you know, it's a thought there that we can make a change, right? I mean, anybody wouldn't want to read this. Got to have something wrong with them. Why would you want to be in a community and you not want to have a change for the positive? And in order to be a little learned in that, in those areas, here's the way to go. This is the way to go. And so we encourage people, and we'll give a shout out in the credits, you know, but we encourage folks in Norristown, especially in any way around Norristown, to read this book that you've put together. It's just extraordinary. Extraordinary that you would take the time, invest the time in our community. And, you know, going forward, what do you see, you know, your work and our work needs to be?
Well, let's
pick your partner. Yeah. You're in now. So.
Picking up on the point I was making earlier, just about the river, the simplest one. Today, the river has changed 180 degrees from what it used to be. Nobody ever wanted to live along the river. Okay, if you did, you were a bum or a transient or something along that line. You couldn't afford to live anywhere else. This was true in my particular community of Port Indian, where I lived for 36 years. It was known as Dog Patch for the longest period of time. Now,
regatta time.
Yeah, and people moving in there now are commissioning architects to design homes on their land. Okay, so this is evidence. Now, what that means is we have a 180-degree reversal of priorities for residences. In the old days, the floodplain was devoted to industry and commerce. People tried to live far away. Today, the industries are gone. The commerce is almost entirely gone. The railroads are almost entirely gone. What you have is, let's call it buildable land along the floodplain next to what is now a beautiful scenic river. And this is where people want to live. The Conshohockens are evidence of that.
Right.
This is a 180-degree change.
Well, you know, I've been following, you know, the rebirth, so to speak. It's been going on. I worked in the planning department for the borough in 78, 79. Dick Schmore was my boss. And we had meetings then on turning, you know, the town around. And the river was discussed then. What has kept us from making a move to, you know, have that river area developed?
Well, it has been developed in the fundamental sense, beginning with what was known back then as the Philadelphia to Valley Forge bike trail.
Yes,
the first
yes.
attempt to use yes. the river for Riverside for recreation. It's
right.
now the Schuylkill Valley Trail.
Okay.
It runs up the entire river. It's going to connect to several other trails. We have a transportation change here that goes along with the change in what's happening down along the river itself. In the old days, the good old days, residence and recreation were the two lowest priorities for life along the river. Today, they should be the highest. In other words, if Norristown looks to bring back industry or to bring back commercial business, they're looking in the wrong direction. They need to exploit what they have, and what they have most of all, their primary asset, is the river.
You know, just looking back a little bit, you see that the government ran the town, but it was largely not influenced by the people, in my view. Now you have young people, young adults in Norristown, who have a spirit that's unmatched in our history, especially underserved kind of folks, if you will. They're not underserved at all, in my view, but you know, they're not the majority, the typical majority population. They've done, you know, athletic programs for children and adults. They've done family day celebrations, I mean, Father's Day celebrations, a lot of different activities, self-funded, you know, not relying on the government. And I think they want something better, but they have to make the move to the government. Or where does, it can't happen out there at a baseball field. Where does it happen at?
There must be a connection. And one of the things that people have told me, you know, as I was researching this book, I spent a lot of time just talking to people, which is actually to say listening to them. I ask them short questions and then go from there. Among them were people who were, say, journalists or people who have studied the area, maybe inadvertently because they're writing on a daily basis, for a very long period of time. And one of the ones that I respect most, I'm going to give no names, said to me, you know, Mike, he said, there's a disconnect between the government and the people of Norristown. Now, I think in very many ways there's always been a disconnect between the government and at least some of the people of Norristown. Because in the old days, your local leaders, your political leaders, your economic leaders, your social leaders, they were essentially the same thing. They were homegrown, they had their own businesses here, they had an investment in the community. And this is the problem that faces not just Norristown, but everyone else. In the old days, every social force in America worked to coalesce communities. Okay? This was, if you lived in a town, you worked in that town, you often could walk to work, you were that close, you worshiped on weekends, you shopped, and such time as you had for recreation, you spent in that town. The town was your life. You cared for it, and you cared to make it better. Now, I don't mean that people care for it less, but they are being affected by things totally extraneous to Norristown, to Pennsylvania, and in fact to the United States, beginning with the radio, then to television, and now with the internet and the movie theaters and everything else. What do you do in a town besides live there? The industries are gone. Right. If you want to have your recreation, you're going to go somewhere else, or you're going to sit in your room, turn on the internet, you know, and be entertained as if you were in anywhere part of the world. So what we have today is a centrifugal force working against communities. You want to take your focus outside of your communities. Now, this is a problem I think that that Conshohocken is having, because the people moving into Conshohocken aren't moving in for the same reasons that people used to. They're not likely to work in Conshohocken, only a very small number. They are moving to the Conshohockens because they have great access to transportation.
Exactly.
Now that, I mean, West Conshohocken, and thus Conshohocken, sits right at the intersection of two interstate highways. So you can live in Conshohocken and work a great distance away in any number of directions.
Well, how will this Lafayette run, this, mm-hmm. this extension? Lafayette, everybody's buzzing about it. It's actually being done as we speak. How would that affect?
This was the specific thing that said to me, it's time to start writing about the revival of Norristown. Because many of the factors that helped to take Norristown down and all of the other towns were totally extraneous to Norristown, okay? They could not be touched one way or the other. But the one that probably contributed the most after the loss of industry was the change from rails to the automobile. These were very compact towns. The last thing anyone ever thought of was providing parking. It just didn't exist. And so Norristown, which I wrote about in my previous book, spent decades trying to solve the parking problem. They never did. Okay. Now, in many cases, that's no longer a problem because all of the businesses have gone.
Right.
But it still comes down to ultimately looking at this. And back in 1950, when the turnpike first terminated in King of Prussia, they immediately began to plan for a extension to the Delaware River. The first plan for that put an exit, an interchange for the turnpike right exactly in the end, almost exactly where it's going to be now. Yeah. Back in the 1950s, when Norristown heard about this, Everyone, and I do not exaggerate when I say everyone, I mean everyone, thought it was a horrible idea. They argued against it. They petitioned against it. They went to Harrisburg.
Everyone meaning that supported this.
Everyone
community?
In the community itself. Any social leader, so, political leader, economic leader.
Wait a minute. How do you find this stuff out? Where do you get those comments? It's just not specifically, but you got some good information about what we thought back in those days. Where do you find that at?
Primarily through the Times Herald. Okay. One of the nice things for a historian
is
the fact that we had a good community newspaper. It was full of news about the community. Now, that's no longer the case, for which I have no blame cast on people who work there. They're doing the very best they can
it's a different situation. It's a different world.
But when you look at this, this was something that rather surprised me, because now we think, oh, Turnpike, it's going to really bring some money. But back then, nobody thought that. Now, I can extend that. In Upper Merion, when the Turnpike first came in, all they could talk about was loss. They were going to lose this land and so on and so forth. And the treasurer of Upper Merion Township predicted, he was very unhappy, that this would hurt the township because they were taking away taxable property.
What year was
1950.
Around? Okay, then the next thing you know, they got the biggest shopping center in the whole world.
Exactly.
Because of the transportation access.
Which is why I don't fault the people in Norristown so much back then, because that history didn't exist. We look back and say, well, why didn't you see that? Well, because it didn't exist.
Right.
It hadn't happened at the other turnpike exits prior to that. But it happened here, and the lesson, you know, was clear. This was a very early sign of how things were going to fundamentally change in the retailing and business world.
There seems to be some glimmers of hope appearing even on the main street. The distillery, some of the eateries. It seems like it's coming back, but it's just hard for me to believe that it will be sustainable and expandable, too, with just those kind of businesses. It has to be some kind of, technology concerns or whatever to go along with that.
Yeah, to make it expandable and sustainable is a further issue.
Okay.
Now, right now, the reason, as I mentioned, we come back to that Lafayette Street extension.
Right.
Norristown is now going to have a very close by connection. It's going to go from the turnpike through very close to the downtown area and then terminate at 202.
Right.
And there isn't much land that can be developed between the turnpike and Norristown. Now, I say that because I want to contrast with what they used to call the Pottstown Expressway. Okay, when they were building this, was the lifeline to a beleaguered borough.
422.
422. They called it the Pottstown Expressway. That was pure politics and pure public relations. There was never any intention to develop Pottstown. The point was to develop the land between King of Prussia and Pottstown.
And they did that.
That's exactly what happened.
The spring forward.
Okay. And so when you have an access to a interstate highway that terminates at your greatest asset, the river, then you have the two ends of a road that could get going. Now, sustainable and expandable is quite another thing.
You know, a lot of people don't understand, and we teach this, we try to teach political action and whatever in the community. They don't understand the relationship between their voices and what's done by the government. And if you research and understand and take viable requests to them, they have to look at it, and you have to stay on it until it's looked at. Because I think too many of us in the past, we say things, we complain about things, but we don't stay on it. And a lot of times we don't have a record of why we want a certain thing done. Mm-hmm. And the thing about Pottstown, that was very slick the way you explained that. They sort of got faked out. But look at the way that area has thrived, and the new high school that's been, Springford and the whole thing. And we're not against those folks developing that area as long as it's legal. But it's just we gotta take some plans and and get them started here. A gentleman that I know that I can't mention his name, he was a legislator and a big time operator, businessman that came from this town, and he felt back in the 60s that a medical center approach could be implemented here, because we had like two or three hospitals and the whole one. It got shot down. The government shot it down. And now we're back at that, that same point. So Yeah, we got to give us some, we got to take ideas and, you know, develop mm-hmm. ideas and research.
Indeed. And the, I don't want to overemphasize a couple of basic points, but again, I come back to residence and recreation. This is what is going to build the towns in the future.
Residence
okay.
and recreation.
Business on a large scale, like it was, is not coming back.
Gotcha.
Now, as everyone who administers a municipality knows, the residences in your area cost more in services than they return in taxes. That's a truism of real estate anywhere.
Okay. Okay.
And so a purely residential or recreational community is not going to thrive.
You're telling me if I pay $4,000 a year in taxes, the services that are coming back to me are beyond that.
I'm speaking in generalities now. You take an entire area, certainly not the individuals,
right.
But this is, there's a curve to this, because as communities age, and particularly perhaps some other community becomes more popular, you see this happen. But even so, it's a basic truism. So you want business. If you don't have business, you have continual financial troubles. But now I'm going to take an exception, and I'm going to write about it within a few weeks. Fairly recently, Stan Husky, editor of the Times Herald, wrote a compelling piece that the business of Norristown should be business. I respectfully disagree. It was business back in the days when the business of America was business, as Cal Coolidge put it. But if you focus on that today, you're missing the point. Now, I've been doing a number of blogs on this subject, and I've come up with an expression that I repeat ad nauseum to people. I say, make it safe, clean it up, and they will come. Okay. They, in this case, are people, not businesses. Business follows people. Now, I also divide between two kinds of businesses, a very rough comparison here. Does your business serve primarily the local community, or does it produce something, whatever that may be, for broader distribution? Okay. Now, the first part of these, the businesses that serve the community, what I call service businesses, these are the ones we're trying to lure to Norristown. That we're giving out grants and so on and so forth. Now, I mean nothing whatsoever against any of the businesses who want to come in Norristown. I say very good for you. But I'm of the opinion that the government should not spend any money to bring a service business to Norristown. You can bring it there, but will it be able to live? Will it be able to continue? That will depend on the number of people that he can get to come into its business. And so when you have
give me some examples of a service.
Restaurants. Bars, or for that matter, retail commercial, because we're not going to compete on the big scales with, you know, with the big ones out in the malls, but we call these days boutique stores, the things you kind of see in Phoenix.
So you're saying we
example.
Shouldn't seek to bring them in?
No, I'm saying you definitely want to bring in businesses, but you want to distinguish between the types of businesses, okay? You know that service businesses will come if you have people coming into town, people with money, okay, people with young families. We're not talking about people who move to Norristown because it's going to their Section 8 voucher is going to cover more of the rent there.
Right.
These are not the kind of people you want in.
Right.
But people who will come in, and when they begin to come in, okay, the businesses are going to notice. And they will bring themselves in because they see a long-term future.
Gotcha.
Now, if Norristown has the opportunity to bring to the municipality a business that maybe if it even creates software, I don't care what creates,
right.
Obviously you try to do that. Okay, you give them aid, but not what I would call service businesses. Put people first.
Well, listen, I'm so glad we got together. And do you have anything in closing?
It's hard to wrap up this kind of thing, but I really do think that Norristown not only on the cusp of a revival, but it has the opportunity to serve as an example far beyond the boundaries even of Pennsylvania. Because here is the fascinating thing about Norristown. It no longer has a white majority. It always has, and all of the other towns on the Schuylkill River still do. But here in Norristown, not only do you not have a white majority, you don't have a majority of anybody. You have three, and I'm oversimplifying here, basic communities, okay? White, black, and Hispanic. Now, not only that, they are almost the same size. So who can be your oppressors? This is a laboratory. This is a community for people to come together and say, okay, you're of a different race, you're of a different ethnicity, but we're in this same boat together. And if we can do that in Norristown, that's a lesson that's going to not only be good for Norristown, it's going to be good for a great many different things.
You know, working here as a counselor for a number of years, we had parents' night or report card night or whatever you want to call it. And I ran into a Latino parent who came up to see about her child here. Now, she had another child at Paul Fly School, which is over on Potshop Road. She walked from that school over to our school, and it just blew me away. Mm-hmm. And we got folks that won't even come up here and drive. So we really have some great, great people, no matter what color they are. But we just got to help and support, and take a little risk.
Okay. Let's get your thoughts
move aside, and accept the fact that this is who we are now. And we're very proud of it. I'm very proud to be a product of the school system, even though I hear a lot of stuff, even in the community I live in right now in West Norton, I hear a lot of derogatory stuff because kids don't go to our school. But I understand. I understand why you would think that way. But if you walk the halls here and you go into the classrooms here, you see a totally different picture. So I want to thank you, and hopefully we'll get you back again. And obviously, you know, folks, Mr. Tolle's book, they've been down so long, getting up, still on their minds. It's a great book about how communities are transformed. And we like to get him back here sometimes, hopefully. And we definitely want you to connect with the Citizens for Better Norristown Facebook page, because his blog appears there routinely. And we want to thank you, and good luck.
Thank you very much. Sure. My pleasure.
Yes.